Love. Good morning. Good morning and welcome to Broken Chains Biker Church, the Power Hour. Wow. We're in a different facility this part of the roadhouse this morning. So if it looks like I'm broadcasting from a cave in Holbrook, I assure you that I'm not. We're right here at 27 Maple Ave on the fourth floor. Welcome to Broken Chains Biker Church. You're welcome in the patch and colors that you wear, your t-shirt, your jeans, tattoos, and long hair, piercings and boots, crew cuts or business suits, Izod sweater or trash can tatters. All are welcome at the throne of the living God. Black, yellow, red, and white, we are all welcome here tonight. For right now, right here, we are all equal in his sight. He was born of a virgin, fulfilled prophecies, taught outcasts and outlaws, took the punishment that belongs to us all, suffered death on a cross, was buried and rose again, defeating death. He taught and appeared to thousands after rising. All authority in heaven on earth were given to him, and he sent the Holy Spirit for those who would accept his gifts. We, his people, empowered, walking in his will change the world from darkness to light, because we are mercy sought, blood bought, and spirit filled. Amen.
Break every chain.
Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time of sharing right now. Hide me behind your cross. Let your words come forward and minister to your people. In Jesus' name we pray. The words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight. O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Amen. Well, here we are another Sunday. And for some of us, it's another year because, yes, today is my birthday. Which is interesting because my birthday is one day after Pastor Deb's birthday. So I don't know if she knows. Same day? The 27th? I thought, because I saw it on Facebook that it was everybody was saying happy birthday today, so I thought it was yesterday. Today is my birthday. Yes. Hers was yesterday. Okay, good. We got that cleared up. So, happy birthday, Pastor Deb. I would sing you a song, but I'm sure you've suffered enough in your life. I've already heard from many people that have wished me happy birthday. My mommy called me this morning and sang to me. And only a mother, you got to love when mother sings to you. We don't need another hero. The theme of the movie Mad Max 3 Beyond Thunderdome was written by Terry Britton and Graham Lyle, and it was a popular song sung by, obviously, Tina Turner, in which a burned-out ex-police officer played by Mel Gibson, who was once driving the last of the V8 Interceptors and Cock of the Walk, is now a raggedy man, and he must try to survive in a post-apocalyptic world. While on his journey, wandering through the vast wasteland, he was hijacked. His wagon and all his possessions were stolen. They left him to wander out in the desert alone. And as he's wandering, he comes across a city of sorts called Bartertown. Now, Bartertown was run by the ruthless Auntie Enmity, who was played by Tina Turner, whose only qualifications to lead Bartertown was that after the crash of civilization, she was alive. Sometimes it takes just surviving to be in charge. Now, Bartertown was as wicked and dangerous as it could be. It was run by the simplest of rules. Well, only two, actually. First, when it comes to business, bust a deal and face the wheel. The wheel is loosely based on the Wheel of Fortune, however, way more severe than the game show, in which you can win money, prizes, or a trip to Europe. Bartertown's wheel was way more deadly. The prizes range from death to exile and everything in between. As the wheel was spun, whatever comes up, that was your punishment. The second rule had to do with personal disputes. If two people could not or will not agree, they are sent to Thunderdome. And for this, everybody knows this, Thunderdome is where, everybody say it with me, two men enter and one man leaves. So just so you can get the full picture of the Thunderdome, you can't break any rules because there aren't any. Boy, Bartertown sounds a lot like some parts of Holbrook, doesn't it? The song goes, out of the ruins, out from the wreckage. Can't make the same mistake this town, this time. We are the children, the last generation. We are the ones they left behind. And I wonder when we're ever going to change, living under the fear till nothing else remains. Now, I chose that song because it fits very appropriately with the chosen people of God. The Hebrews have been liberated from their oppressor, the Egyptians. The Most High God has heard the cries of his people and has sent a liberator, one he gave the power to perform miracles, one who had the power to alter the metaphysical structure of basic elements such as water, which he changes to blood. He changes wood to snakes. He even calls darkness from broad daylight. Plus seven other signs that were given to show a Pharaoh whose mind was so twisted, Pharaoh actually thought he was God and had the right to control the Hebrews as his property. Well, you know, God does not take lightly to imitation gods. He's a jealous God. And he has warned mankind that we are to have no other gods before him. He calls Moses. Moses is an unlikely ruler. And we're going to discover what makes him so unlikely as we go along. His upbringing was miraculous. He was hidden as a child from a mass killing. You see, Pharaoh ordered the killings of all the Hebrew boys. Jochebed lived in Egypt, where the descendants of Israel, the Jews, were being oppressed. Jochebed is Pharaoh's mother. Pharaoh had decreed that all their baby boys were to be thrown into the Nile, because he had feared that they might become too powerful when they got older. You know, the war against children is not new. It started long time ago. When Moses, her youngest child, was born, Jochebed hid him for the first 3 months until she could hide him no longer. To save her son's life, she made a wooden chest of burl brush, made it watertight with slime and pitch, and she put the child in it. Then she let the child float down the river Nile. Miriam, her daughter, kept watch from a distance. As the baby floated down the river, Pharaoh's daughter, who had come to the river to bathe, saw the child, and moved with compassion, she picked the child up and out of the water, and she set herself to adopt him. Now, Miriam had seen all this, so she came forward and suggested to Pharaoh's daughter that she find a Hebrew woman to nurse the baby. Pharaoh's daughter agreed, because although she wanted to take care of the child at that time, there was no way to buy formula or anything, so you needed a mother who was in fact lactating in order to nurse the baby. So Miriam called her mother, who was appointed to take care of him. Thus, Jochebed nursed her own son until he was old enough and brought him to Pharaoh's daughter, who adopted him as her son. Ver, tighten the shot. Rocker switch, yes. You see, when you trust God, excellent. Well, perfect, right there. When you trust God and lean not to your own understanding, he will work it out. And his decision will always be better than you can possibly come up on your own. You think about it. Your enemy sets a trap for you because you trust God. Not only does a trap not catch you, but it ends up catching the person who set the trap. In other words, Pharaoh wanted to destroy all of the Hebrew babies. Ends up paying the mother of the baby who he tried to destroy to raise the baby up through his own household. That is how God works things. He will set the things that are set against you, and he will turn them for your benefit. All because you trust in God. So this one who is slow of speech, this murderer, this one who God calls to a burning bush, is Moses. The song says, we don't need another hero. We don't need to know the way home. All we want is life beyond the Thunderdome. Now, when the king of Egypt had heard that all the people had fled, the heart of the Pharaoh and his servants was turned against the people, and he said, why have we done this? Why have we let Israel go from serving us? You see, when your heart is not right, Satan takes every opportunity to cause all the evil in your soul, in your heart, to completely destroy you. There is no reason why you would pursue a people that God had caused to be free. And he caused it to be free in such a dramatic fashion, releasing 9 plagues. All of the plagues, by the way, which were designed to pick at each one of the gods that the Egyptians had worshipped. It was designed to show the fallacy of those gods. Every plague that God had allowed to had Moses to send forth was designed to speak against a particular god during that time frame. All of which the sorcerers could imitate. Pharaoh had his own sorcerers, except one. And the one that he couldn't imitate was the turning of the water to blood. The sorcerers had no way of reversing that. And what God was trying to show you and show us in the time frame, and to show Pharaoh at that time, was that there is power in the blood, and the power comes from me, not from any imitation source. We sing that song today, there is power in the blood of Jesus. So, back to my text here. There is no reason why you would pursue that type of a person. Pharaoh even calls a plague on him. He thinks he's calling it on the Israelites, the Hebrew people, but it doesn't work that way. By calling it, he said that he called that all of the firstborn would die. Once again, an attack on the children. But God said to tell Moses, to tell him that plague you have called for my people will be on your own. Your own family, your own friends, and your own countrymen. See, when you allow God to have reign in your life, then you don't have to worry about Satan having any victory. But Pharaoh did exactly the opposite. And so by doing so, he gave Satan a victory. For himself, not for God's people, because God's people were out. However, here's the problem. In verse 6 of Exodus, chapter 1, verses 1 through 14, wrote the text in verse 6, he made his chariot ready and took his people with him. He was so angry to pursue the Israelites that he felt he had to do that himself. This is unheard of back at the time. Most of the time, Pharaoh would just send people out. But he is so bent, he's going to go out there and get these people himself. It's clear that not only through his madness, he's about to kill himself, but all of his people that are with him as well. He also took 600 chariots and all the chariots of Egypt and the captains over every one of them. Then verse 8 says, the Lord hardened the heart of Pharaoh, the king of Egypt. Now, there's been many controversies over these sentences where God hardened somebody's heart. So let me break this down for you really quick. Let's be very clear on this. God does not do anything that's counter your own heart. If you have decided in your heart that there is no God, he allows you to maintain that even into death. So Pharaoh's heart was hardened because Pharaoh had already proclaimed from a very own early age, when Moses first appears to Pharaoh, Pharaoh claims to Moses, "Who is this God? I know such no God. I am the God that you should be concerned about." So Pharaoh, having already said in his own heart there is no God, God allows him to keep that. He doesn't let Pharaoh step back from that which is said. That Pharaoh has only said. There's no change in the heart. So because there's no change in Pharaoh's heart, there's no change in how Pharaoh is allowed to act. He's going to act just the way he is. So the Bible reports that his heart is hardened, and he pursued the children of Israel, and the children of Israel went out with boldness. So the Egyptians pursued them, all the horses, the chariots of Pharaoh, his horsemen and his army, and overtook them by camping by the sea, Pi Heroth, before Baal Zephon. When Pharaoh drew near, the children of Israel lifted up their eyes, and behold, the Egyptians had marched against them. And they were afraid, and the children of Israel cried out to the Lord. Then they said to Moses, "Because there were no graves in Egypt, have you taken us to die in the wilderness?" We pick up the song where a verse says, looking for something we can rely on. There's got to be something better out there. Love and compassion, their day is coming. All else are castles built in the air. And I wonder when we are ever going to change, living under the fear till nothing else remains. See, how could the Israelites so quickly forget what the Lord God had done in freeing them? How could they forget love and compassion that God had shown them? Not only did the people of Israel have to leave, but they were able to take whatever they wanted from their captors. Let's not forget that even though the Egyptians had made the Israelites slaves, it was because of the Israelites' ancestors' rebellion that was causing them the pain. You see, the Israelites had rejected God earlier, and because they rejected God, God allowed them to go back into slavery. When you reject God, he gives you what you got coming. He just lets you go on, and you end up being in slavery because you're rejecting God. Not only, and here's the thing, when you're a slave, you're not able to build something for yourself or your family. Your desires, things that you want, mean nothing to those who enslave you. On one hand, you have your life, your health, and your strength. You're able to work, you're able to pray, and you have a family. But on the other hand, none of that is real because it doesn't belong to you. So the only thing that you really have at that point in time is your family, and you only have them in so much as the people who are enslaving you don't take them from you. So really all you have at that point in time is God. And if you've rejected him, if you're being disobedient to him, and you find yourself in a situation where you're being punished through your slave, there are many times we find ourselves in situations where we are being punished, we have been enslaved by our own making. We understand that we're only bringing in $1,000 a month, so we sign a car note for $450. That's a form of slavery. There's no way you can pay a $450 note. You got to pay lights, gas, and rent, and pay most of that on a car note. That's a form of slavery that you put yourself in. So, a long time ago, your ancestors did something that caused all this. They turned their back on God, and now you, your family, and the nation of Israel is paying the price. Turning away from God always costs. But here we have a situation where a man comes to town. He says that God, the God that you have been praying to, has sent him to bring you to freedom and be a sense of deliverance. To get these Egyptians off your back, he has heard you, and he has been sent there to free you, your family, and your nations, and so you follow him. But it's not a bed of roses. It's not a pleasure cruise. And you have to pack quickly, and you have to go. But the children still say, "We don't need another hero. We don't need to know the way home. All we want is life beyond the Thunderdome. So now we have the Egyptians rolling up on the Israelites who are standing at the edge of the Red Sea. They look and they see that Pharaoh's army is approaching. They are trapped and they cry out to Moses and say, why did you do this to us? Were there no graves in Egypt that we could die? This God, and I imagine one person standing, he's in a point of despair, and he says, this God that Moses talks to, he says that God has a plan, and we're just going to walk across the sea on dry land. Still, I wish I could believe. The songwriter says, so what do we do with our lives? We leave only a mark. Will our story shine like a light or end in the dark? Give it all or nothing. A man called Moses was called to do a job. He was human with all the fragilities, the fears, and in his own righteousness, he feels like he has the answer as he takes vengeance on his oppressors. Killing an Egyptian guard who was beating a slave, you would think that this is a heroic act because he's standing up. But the reality of it is, it's not heroism, it's murder. And after this great act of heroism, he runs like the common murderer that he is. He runs to Midian, but interestingly enough, it is there he meets God. And now, his nature to protect is going to be channeled, it's going to be shaped, and God is going to use it as an instrument for his own glory, as opposed to Moses committing murder in his own strength. So, Moses is now in Midian. As he comes to Midian, he protects a shepherdess at the local. Mother of the shepherdess that he protects is so impressed that he adopts Moses, offers and gives him one of his daughters to marry. Moses is just living his life. He's married. He has a good job. He's managing his father-in-law's business. Life is good. And then in steps God. And God gives Moses a mission. He's going to lead Moses' people out of bondage. But once again, the interesting thing about this is that Moses is not going to lead these people out of bondage from some remote village. Moses is going to have to go right back into the very same situation that he ran from some 40 years ago. He's going to go back and face the same people that he thought he had left behind. God does not allow you to move on until you resolve the issues that caused you to run in the first place, even with him. But Moses is strengthened by God. And he's able to lead a movement. He's able to free a people. He's able to give a law. And that law that he gave is still in use today. All the leading, all the guidance, and the voice of the Lord God is what Moses used. Moses was not a hero. He is a servant. We are called to be servants, not heroes. We don't need another hero. We know the way home. We're just waiting for Jesus the Christ to come and take us to his own, to our own, to his home. Let me do that again. We don't need another hero. We know the way home. We're just waiting for Jesus the Christ to come and take us to his own. Amen. Our announcements. No. Wait, you know what? You're actually right. I will do the announcements. Let me do the altar call first. Christ. You're actually correct.
You were on it, a holy king, a carpenter.
If something has been said that causes you to realize that you don't need another hero, that who you need in your life is Jesus the Christ, what you need is
come on, Houston, you can say it one time with us.
Send down from
many things. Come on, somebody.
What you need is somebody that can use you right where you are. And if you don't think God can use you, let me tell you about something, some of the people he's used in the past. Noah was a drunk. Abraham was too old. Isaac was a daydreamer. Jacob was a liar. Leah was ugly. Joseph was abused. Moses himself had a stuttering problem. Gideon was afraid. Rahab was a prostitute. Jeremiah and Timothy were both way too young. David had an affair and also was a murderer. Elijah was suicidal. Isaiah preached naked. Jonah ran from God. Naomi was a widow. Job went bankrupt. Peter denied Christ. The disciples fell asleep while praying. Martha worried about everything. The Samaritan woman was divorced. Zacchaeus was too small. Paul was too righteous. Timothy had an ulcer. And the ultimate, Lazarus, was dead. You see, God can use whoever he wants in any situation. If your life is not coming together, if you just can't sing together, get it together, and you've tried everything else, I'm sorry to say that you should have tried Jesus first. Try him now. He can be your salvation. He will come into your life. He will help you straighten everything out. And more importantly, he'll put you right back on the path, right back in the position where you and God can see each other again, and you can ultimately live forever. God can use pray this prayer with me. Lord, I know I'm a sinner. I've messed up my life. I know that you're the Son of God. I accept that you died for me on the cross for the remission of my sins. I accept you into my heart. Come, take control of my life. You are the head of my life. If you prayed this prayer, you're saved. That's it. If you're not sure what to do next, make your way to 27 Maple Ave. Come up on Thursday night for the open door. There's many people who will pray with you. You can come in on Fridays. We have Digging In Friday. This coming Friday is going to be actually First Friday. And all of you have a great word, but we have food. You can ask for me. You can ask for Dave, Crazy Dave. You can contact him at 781-421-3188. You can contact me at 781-367-1338. And we will pray with you, and we'll help you to get yourself centered and to walk the walk that you have chosen to walk. We don't want to leave you out there alone. Just come on down. Honey? Thank you. Our announcements as follows. Obviously, Tuesday at 7:45, we have an NA meeting. Wednesday night is the music practice. Anybody that wants to be part of the music ministry here at Broken Chains for either the Friday night or the Sunday morning service, Feel free to stop in on Wednesday. You can contact Eric Brumley or Crazy Dave. We're going to have Bible study in the media room. We have prayer in the classrooms. At 7 o'clock, kids' church, 12 and under. There's dinner that's served. Digging in Fridays. All the services, of course, are live stream, so you can see us on live stream. Just go to brokenchains.com and click on the live stream button, and you'll get to the services that we have. If you need prayer, feel free to contact Crazy Dave at 781-421-3188. We have, on August 3rd, we have the Wheels for Warriors, not wounded, but the second annual Wheels for Warriors. It's going to be held at Raynham Dog Track. There's going to be classic cars, motorcycles, and tow trucks. Broken Chains is going to have a table there. So feel free to come out. It's from 9 a.m. to 4 p.m. at the Raynham Dog Track. Now, on September 21st, Broken Chains Biker Church cordially invites you to join us in celebrating the Lord as one of our brothers has recently been blessed with a sexy black two-wheeled motorcycle with flames all over it. It is only missing the three wheels that he needs to ride it. And on this day, we'll be unveiling Broken Chains Biker Church's new patches as we come alive and welcome the beginning of a new era of mercy sought, blood bought, and spirit filling. So please save the date. Clear your schedule. We invite you and all your friends to this gala event. It's going to include a serene mile bike ride that will make you feel like you're walking on water, followed by our famous smoked meats with all the fixins. Music from the band, from our own harmonious band, will be rocking out the tunes that will make you dance. There will be games, wheelchair races, and raffles to support BACA, the Bikers Against Child Abuse, and a 50-50 to support the Southeastern Massachusetts Motorcyclist Survivors Fund, and to raise funds for our brother. What we're basically going to do, he's got a two-wheeled bike, and we're going to change it into a trike so he can ride it. So we'll be taking up money for that. There'll be vendors, and there'll be different things that you can come and buy. We ask you to come out and support this. There'll be many things. This is a perfect chance, a perfect opportunity for the community to throw their support behind one who is a faithful brother, but because of his situation, he needs a tricycle, and we're going to convert this bike to a tricycle through the money that we raised. Speaking of raising money, here is our sister to talk to you about that. Sister Mary, come on up. Yes, food paper right here. Right, I left the book up instead of Reflections.
Good morning again from Broken Chains Biker Church. This morning, we were listening to a song, Break Every Chain. And as I listened to that song this morning, I recalled the chains that were broken off of finances given by faith. And I'm just going to share the scripture out of Malachi about giving once again. Will a man rob God? Yet ye have robbed me. But ye say, where have we robbed thee? In tithes and offerings? Ye are cursed with a curse, for ye have robbed me, even this whole nation. Bring ye all the tithes into the storehouse, that there may be meat in my house. And prove me therewith, says the Lord of hosts, if I will not open you the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing, that there shall not be room enough to receive it. Did you hear what the Lord says there? He said, to prove me, says the Lord, and I will rebuke the devourer for your sake, and he shall not destroy the fruits of your ground. Neither shall your vine cast her fruit before the time in the field, says the Lord of hosts, and all nations shall call you blessed, for you shall be a delightsome land, saith the Lord. Break every chain. Break every chain. Without faith, it's impossible to please God. But he that comes to God must believe that he is, and he is a rewarder of those that diligently seek him. I found in my times of hardships, of financial hardships, that when I was seeking God by faith, he would speak to me and say, Mary, do you want those chains broken off of your finances? Then I want you to give, Mary. Take what you have in your wallet. Even though you think you don't have enough, and you say, I can't give, God, I can't afford to give. And the Lord would say, Mary, you can't afford not to give. And I would give those finances that I have. And as soon as I did, a weight lifted off of my shoulders. I felt like chains were snapping in my life. Because by faith, I was believing God. And he rewards those who believe him. I encourage you today, if you have chains on your finances, try God, trust God, give, and see if he will not open the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing. Father, we thank you today for the opportunity to give. We thank you for the word that Pastor Walker shared today, Lord, that even those chains, that we can believe Jesus to set us free from our sin. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. We will be glad in it today, Lord. Take this offering we have today, Lord, and multiply it. Continue to provide for this Broken Chains Biker Church and all the ministries. In Jesus' name, amen. I encourage you to listen to this song. Not only will Jesus break the chains of sin in your life, but as you give, he can break the chains off your finances. Sing it out. And you can see that the Lord God Almighty is in charge. He will pour out a blessing. Amen.
We thank you for being a part of this morning's service. We invite you to come down and join us in person. Be part of what we're doing here at Broken Chains. There's a lot of great ministries, a lot of great things going on. And until next week, we'd just like to say that it's one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in you all. And now unto him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly more than we could ask or think, according to the power that worketh in us, unto him the glory in the church by Christ Jesus throughout all ages, world without end. Amen. Consider yourself dismissed.
busy. It's the time that I spend alone, sailing on the cool and bright clear water. It's kind of a special feeling, out on the sea alone, staring at